my job, as I see it, is to try to boost the spiritual morale of everyone. Boost the spiritual morale. Now, yesterday, I became acutely aware of how demoralizing everything is on this planet. It was just hitting me so hard, and I became very demoralized. And I realized we're all swimming in this ocean of that spiritually demoralizes us to an extraordinary extent, and we don't realize it. The emphasis on bodies is extremely demoralizing, spiritually demoralizing. It's just hideous. We hate it, actually. This whole place, world, we hate it. It's a spiritually demoralizing garbage pit, actually. All I did was shift my attention to be aware of what is, and I realized it's going on all the time. No wonder why we're down. No wonder why we feel spiritually suppressed, depressed. And I'm talking about spiritually. Now, physically, you know, the world seems to be happy this. But the more the more physicality, materiality that we get into in this world, the more spiritually demoralizing this place is. It's just incredibly, there's just no spiritual oxygen in this world, actually. It's become anaerobic, spiritually anaerobic. No oxygen. No spiritual oxygen here. Went to the market. I just started noticing people, the way people are dressing, and I just felt, wow, how demoralizing that is. Spiritually demoralizing it is. The way people were presenting themselves. Horrible. And yet we're thinking, oh, that's cute. Oh, that's beautiful. Oh, they look so nice. And then I was looking from a spiritual standpoint. I said, wow, this world is like spiritually under this massive dark clouds, blotting out the sun, so to speak. Like a massive algae bloom that there's no oxygen in the ocean here. Now, we don't even realize how spiritually demoralized we are. That's what I also recognized. We're not even aware of it. But the animalistic way that everybody's acting in this world, actually, is, how could that not be demoralizing? It is. This is incredibly demoralizing. So, how do you boost the spiritual morale of the planet is the question. Maybe, I don't know if it's possible. I've certainly tried various ways, but they haven't worked. So, have to bring something else into the picture here. I found out a lot of stuff. I had a dream last night that really showed a lot of stuff what's going on in this world. So, very bad. This world, no wonder why Jesus condemned it. So this isn't my place at all. This is a place where we're working on disempowering spirit. We're trying to disempower spirit, and that's why we feel so spiritually demoralized here. This is where we go when we want to feel spiritually demoralized, when we want to feel that disempowering spirit is doable. This is where we end up, this world here. And there are lots of other worlds that we could end up to that may be just as bad or worse, or not quite as bad, but similar. So again, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. We're spirit, we're not bodies, we're not form. Spirit is imagining this world as an imaginary, is the imagination of spirit being imagined for the purpose of demoralizing itself, disempowering itself, because it believes that's what God wants it to do, that's what God created it to do, is to demoralize itself. Because if it doesn't disempower, demoralize, and then thereby disempower itself, that God will annihilate it. This is the fundamental delusion that spirit is under, hiding. This hides the real motive of spirit, which is to destroy God, actually, to disempower God, as a way of proving that spirit is greater than God, that spirit has a greater will than God. The only way to do it would be to disempower God, because God is all power, totally empowered, perfectly empowered. So all this is hiding this little secret, supposed secret. It's not a secret, though. So how to raise the morale, spiritual morale? That's the question. Let the light come. Let the light of salvation. The light is not of this world. It cannot be. As Jesus said, this world has nothing to do with what we are. Absolutely nothing to do with it. It is like a movie that we're watching that has nothing to do with the viewers who are watching the movie. It's not having any connection with us at all, except we produced it. But it's a movie that is trying to convince us that we're not what we are. This is what the world is. It's like a movie that is a propaganda movie designed to demoralize us to such an extent that we believe that we're not what we really are, trying to convince us that, and thereby disempower ourselves. So the idea of trying to disempower God, we had to disassociate, because that we can't do that. And so we then believe that the idea of wanting to disempower God actually came from God, that God created us for the purpose of disempowering God, because God wanted to experience disempowerment, and so that we're a special creation to do that. And that, but if we fail to do that, then we'll have failed in what God created us to do. So we will be completely disempowered through that failure. In other words, annihilated. That's why we're frantically trying to figure out how to demoralize and disempower ourselves, our spirit, which is what this world is for. It's just a like a movie, a propaganda movie experiencing 3D movie, like, to demoralize and disempower spirit. This is what it is. And that's being kind. And saying that, that's being kind. I mean, just bodies are so demoralizing. Just viewing a body. And the more we dress up bodies and make them more and more attractive, the more demoralizing it is. This is what I experienced. Went to the market and there's this some lady dressed up, and you know, the way she is dressed is just trying to be so fashionable and cute and attractive, and my reaction was, I felt very demoralized. Like, wow, it's extremely spiritually demoralizing. And I began to realize this is what's going on here. Because so flip the script beautifully. You know, this whole heathenistic, pagan, modern, secular, humanistic, body beautiful, you know, physical culture stuff, it is extremely demoralizing, spiritually demoralizing. That's what it's for. So everyone is working, thinking that they're doing God's will, because they have attributed to God a will that God doesn't have, which is God's will that God be disempowered. God doesn't have any such will. Okay? But we have attributed that to God, to hide the fact that we are trying to dispower God. We say, no, God wants us to dispower God. We were created that way as a mission. And so we're frantically trying to disempower ourselves, which is why we have this culture and this world. This world is here. And this horrible, demoralizing culture, spiritually demoralizing culture that we have in place now, it's just hideous, to say the least, right now. Didn't used to be this bad. Looking at it from a spiritual standpoint, it's like, what is this place? Bodies? What are bodies? What in the world? What a crazy movie this is. Absolutely crazy movie. Now, it's one thing for some transmission from spirit to come into the world. And we maybe listen and say, oh, okay. But it's another thing for someone in this world to say it. It's a different impact, actually. Because we think, oh, if Jesus can say that, because Jesus is spirit, so it's not a problem. But if we say this, oh, it's terrible. You know, we can't think that way. We can't say that here, no. But by saying all this, then hopefully people get a boost in spiritual morale. Say, hey, this doesn't destroy us. It doesn't wreck us. We don't fall apart. You know, it's stressful because you're not supposed, there's taboo against recognizing what this place really is about. But it doesn't cause that kind of, you know, crisis or anything. So that hopefully this should start boosting the morale of everyone's spiritual morale that we all are sorely lacking as we subject ourselves to the cesspool of designed to drag us down, like a black hole designed to drag us down. Into disempowerment, spiritual disempowerment. So Jesus can talk and teaches us truly, but again, I like to hear those that are actually here say it. I really do. That for me has a stronger impact. But a lot of the teaching we've gotten is transmissions from spirit. But we read it and we say, oh, yeah, maybe, but we don't say anything. You see, we don't say anything. But to actually say it here, you know, to speak the truth here is, I believe, what's required in order to boost the spiritual morale of the planet. Not of the planet, but of spirit. Planet is just a projection, imaginary projection that it's a device, a disempowering device is what it is. Now, it doesn't work. But it sure seems like it works because we're always working on making it better. So it seems as though we're caught up in it. We're not really caught up in it. We're caught up in the fact that it doesn't work, which frightens us. So we keep working to make it more intense. So this is the only engagement we really have. We're not really trapped here. But our fear is if we don't make it effective, we'll be annihilated. So we keep working. We're trapped in this compulsive effort to make it more effective. We feel if we fail to disempower ourselves, being that we're one with God, that would be disempowering God. If we fail to do that, then God will step in and annihilate us. This is the basic driving fear we have. And even beyond that, we have a continuity fear, because even if you recognize that fear and give it up, that everything's perfect, like, oh, we don't need to disempower ourselves at all. And the difference between what we've been doing compulsively for so long and then suddenly realizing, I don't need to do a thing to try and disempower myself, or nobody does, nobody needs to. The contrast between those two, you see, is so stark, absolute contrast, isn't it? That we're afraid of that experiencing that moment of seemingly total contrast, right? That's called a continuity fear. To be able to help. I don't know if it's possible to help this world at this point. Everybody's, what I say, is under the influence of some psychic complex, some disempowerment complex, whether it be some seductive goddess. There are many, many, many seductive goddess complexes at work in the world, pretending to be so nice and helpful, but actually being very disempowering. And there are many other complexes too, technological complexes, and many, 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 many devices, psychic complexes we have imagined, which seem to be so benevolent to help us, and they're really hurting us. Because keep in mind that our definition of being helped is to be hurt. We believe we have to disempower ourselves. So how do we seduce ourselves? We have to seduce ourselves into that, because we don't really want to do this. It feels alien to us, doesn't it? Because we are spirit. So disempowering what we are feels alien to us, yet we feel if we don't do that, we'll be in that. God will annihilate us. So we need to seduce ourselves into disempowerment, which is what we do. This is what we do. And we have, we come up with some very, very, very seductive, seemingly helpful imagery and belief and complexes, which siren songs, the sirens, beautiful seductive women luring us to disempowerment, luring us to, so we lure ourselves to disempowerment. These are all projections, psychic projections, imaginary projections, but they act with great intelligence because they are our projections. They seem to be all-knowing, can't seem to be like, goddesses that are all-knowing and all-kind and know exactly how to maneuver us. And we think, this must be divine grace at work. It's not. It's our own psychic projections, our own projections from spirit, luring us into situations that seem to be disempowering us. So Jesus always says, what this world does is help in order to hurt. Help another to hurt in order to hurt. This is one of the key understandings we have to have. And God knows all of us have been engaged with that for a long time. We've all experienced this, being pulled down into a situation we thought that started out so promising. This is going to be wonderful. This is great. And it ends up feeling like, wow, I feel so totally cut off and isolated and disempowered. And this is horrible, just terrible. This is, again, we simply lured ourselves into the situation that we also have imagined in order to give us the impression that we are disempowered, in order to prevent God from annihilating us, is what we believe. Now, of course, this is a mistaken belief. This belief is mistaken. God is all. God cannot annihilate itself. It's all one. We are, all is God. All is God always. Pure potentiality. God did not create any, God doesn't have any will to annihilate itself, or because it is all. God cannot create something with the will to annihilate itself or annihilate God. All this is just total rubbish. And we had a whim, because we're totally free, we had this silly whim of seeing if our will could be stronger than God's. And the only way that could express itself is then to try and disempower God. But disempowering God in any way at all, since God is all one, it would have to be a total disempowerment. It has to be total annihilation. No such thing as partial disempowerment. So, like I say, it's very helpful to get teachings like Journey Beyond Words. Very helpful. Very, very helpful. People here in this world, they say, it's easy to say that because you're not disempowered, but we're doing the hard work down here. We're disempowering ourselves here, and they don't believe that this can be relayed here. When you're here in this world, seeming with a body and all, they say no, it's not possible. So this is why it's very difficult when you're here to speak up like I'm speaking up. Causes a great deal of stress, actually. There's a taboo against that. In other words, This place is dedicated to disempowering spirit. Okay. Now, when you're not here, it may seem it's not the spirit is not working to disempower itself so much. So it's easy for him to speak this way. But here in this world, which is dedicated to severely dedicated to spiritual disempowerment, we think, well, it's different here. You know, there's a different truth here, and you can't say that here. When you're here, you can't realize that here. So it's tough, very tough to speak up while you're here and speak the truth while you're in this world. Very difficult. Which is why it's not being done very much at all. There are people studying, but they don't speak up. The difficult part is speaking up, as it's way easier to study than it is to try and put in words and speak up in this world. Supremely difficult. Because everybody's saying, you can't say that. Because they think that you're preaching that they're annihilation. So they think that you're Lucifer or Satan or terrible, evil, you know, because the way they interpret it is that you're preaching their annihilation because you're telling them to give up your efforts to disempower yourself. In fact, they're all futile. And they believe that these efforts must succeed or else God will annihilate them. So this is the crazy dialectic here in the world. Totally insane. You can't win. I mean, I don't blame those who are not in this world helping us. I mean, I don't think they want to be here. They don't want to come here to this snake pit. But let's figure, well, I'm here, I might as well speak up. What else is there to do? At least it helps me from being, you know, too demoralized, although the situation in the world now is just, you just look at it and you just say, what can you do about it all? This place is dedicated to spiritual disempowerment and demoralization. Dedicated to it. Fanatically dedicated to it. And I realized yesterday afternoon and evening, my whole life has been a battle against being spiritually demoralized and desperately searching for something here, anything to keep me from being demoralized, you know, whether it be music, you know, everything I've done in my life is a frantic search to keep from being demoralized here, spiritually demoralized. The books I've studied, the teachings, but none of it has worked really. This place is still, you know, horribly demoralizing. And of course, I just try to stay away from people. I just be a recluse. Because as soon as I go out and see the way people are funk presenting and everything they're interested in, it's so demoralizing. That's what it's for. This is what this planet is for. So at least recognizing this is a load off your back, you know. And you don't have to hate the planet, but you put it in the right perspective. You know the old saying, it's a nice place to visit, but I sure wouldn't want to live here. Well, I want to amend that a little bit. This is a terrible place to visit, and I sure don't want to live here. It's not even a good place to visit, this planet. Not at all. Not in the slightest bit. And see, the crazy thing is, everyone on the planet thinks that they're getting the job done. They're doing a great job. Right? They are. If the job is to spiritually demoralize ourselves. To the point of disempowering ourselves. So we are doing a great job, seemingly, except it's futile. It doesn't work, actually work, but that's the attitude. The attitude of the world is that we're winning. The world is winning. It's winning the battle against what it feels is this terrible opponent, which is really just spirit, the inviolability of spirit, God's will, perfection. It's winning the battle against spiritual perfection by demoralizing spirit. So the world thinks it's winning. And then to come in here and say, no, you're not winning at all. It's futile what you're trying to do. It's like, everybody's bristles, you know. So what are you talking about? We're winning here. So it's tough to find an audience for this, you know. I haven't really, you know, people are too frightened. they all want to cut a compromise. What they say is, whoa, you know, slow down there, cowboy. What they're doing is, well, okay, so we're going a little too fast, too strong here, and trying to demoralize ourselves. Okay, we'll back off a little bit. We'll make a compromise. We'll kind of back off for a little while until you feel a little more comfortable, and then we'll go in. You know, this is what the world is. Compromise. What do you mean compromise? Either we can spiritually demoralize ourselves or we can't. Either we can disempower ourselves, which we're God. Either we can disempower God or we can't. There's no middle ground there. There's no middle ground compromise of, well, we'll disempower part of God and leave the other, empowered. There's no such thing as part of God. So it's utter delusion to speak of compromise in that way. Total delusion. And this is what the world, when you try to speak up, and then they say, oh, okay. Well, okay, what part do we want to disempower? What part do we want to leave empowered? It's duality, right? So duality says, oh, we got compromises. We got plenty of them for you. This is even more demoralizing, right? For spirit to talk of compromise is extremely demoralizing. It shows insanity. So this is a place spirit is trying to drive itself insane. That's what spirit's doing. It's trying to drive itself insane. Literally. Now, it can't, but it can sure try. And in the trying of it, it's horrible. Time, space, process, and form is how spirit is trying to drive itself insane, plain and simple. Now, people listening to this say, I can't listen to it. The goddess is going to be furious with me, you know, because the goddess is the one that's helping, telling you how to drive yourself insane, supposedly. But keep in mind, you can't drive yourself insane. You're just wasting your time listening to these psychic goddess complexes and various tech complexes and all this, whatever it is that you feel is most convincing to you, you know, telling you this stuff, how to drive yourself insane. How spirit can drive itself insane. That's what the teachers of this world, the teachers that we have imagined, that's what they're there for. That's what they're doing, advising us. Jesus lumps that all together and calls it, quote unquote, the ego, which is a psychoanalytical term, which I tend not to use so much. Because how it actually plays out is not just some nothing. The advisors we have take on form and appearance and qualities that are very attractive and seductive. Like I say, goddess forms. And are so beguiling and saying, follow me, listen to my advice. I will save you, she says. I will save you. But of course, remember, her definition of saving is to succeed in disempowering ourselves so God won't annihilate us. So in other words, the goddess's definition of salvation is to succeed in driving ourselves totally insane. She says, yeah, I'll help you succeed. I know how to do that. And we say, oh, thank you, goddess. I'm so worried about God annihilating me. God is so mean. God wants to annihilate me and gave me this horrible task. I don't know how to do it. I'm so difficult. I can't figure it out. It's just, I hate God. God is so, you know, demanding. It's horrible. She says, oh, don't worry, child. Your mother is here, the God. I will help you, lead you. You will succeed, and God will no longer be angry at you. But what she's saying is, I will teach you how to drive yourself insane, and therefore God will be so pleased with you and say, oh, you did succeed in disempowering yourself. How wonderful. What a wonderful child I have created that did what I asked them to do. This is the madness that we're in, okay? This is just plain, simple. It's not difficult to understand. This is what's going on. This is the situation we have generated for ourselves, the madness, trying to drive ourselves insane. Thinking this is salvation, using these very seductive teachers that we think is going to help us, being afraid of God and being angry at God, saying, God, you gave us this impossible task, you know, but we have to do it, you'll annihilate us, and then they're being very vulnerable to these our psychic projections, teachers who say, tell us, oh, don't worry, there's a way, we'll show you the way. And then we continue to try and drive ourselves insane, disempower ourselves. And this is what's happened to me. I mean, I've been through this. Absolutely. It's terrible. And I always feel like something isn't right. Something isn't right here. Something is really wrong. But the fear, you know, and the fact that everyone in the world, you see, if you come to this world and you want to try to help, everyone in this world believes that helping, the way to help is to drive everybody insane. The way to help is to help disempower them. And since these teachers that they've been listening to for so long, which are our own projections actually, they believe that these teachers are the way, that they know how to save us from this terrible, angry God. That therefore, whatever you say has to align with what their teachers have been telling them, otherwise they won't trust you. So it's easy to get flipped in this world and go along with this nonsense here. Very easy, because if you say anything true here, they think that you're out to annihilate them. So what they want is to be shown how to disempower yourself. So you end up getting trapped in disempowering yourself, which is what I got trapped into. So I feel like extremely disempowered, and then I feel like, hey, how come this isn't, you know, how come this hasn't helped? It's not helping. And the goddess says, oh yes, you just haven't quite finished. You know, if you just finished, then you'll be able to, you'll be an example, a savior to the world. So the goddess tries to get the savior of the world, tries to disempower someone completely, so that then they can be, she says, you'll be now a savior of the world. Okay, because you'll show you one, see, it's possible, you can do it. There is a way, just listen to the goddess, she'll be able to guide you to where you've been guided to and succeeded. This is literally what takes place here, what I've literally been through. And thanks to Jesus and the Holy Spirit to gradually point this out to me, you know, and say this, because I ask, what's going on here? But deep down, knowing that something, you know, I got things flipped upside down on me here, coming into this world, trying to help out. So, I'm sure people who are listening to this, those who are listening to this, at some level are feeling some sort of hope. They're saying, wow, maybe there is some hope for me. Wow. This is really a big wow to be able to speak like this so plainly here, because I've never heard this spoken like this plainly in here. I've searched for anyone who is willing to speak plainly about this, and I've never found anyone. It's very demoralizing also, isn't it? Very demoralizing. Now, people would rather have nobody speak here at all about this, thinking that it's not possible, than have one person speak up. Because if one of us speaks up here, then the contrast, they'll realize, oh my God, this is what's supposed to be said. No one else is saying it. There's only one person saying it. Oh, how demoralizing, you know? So it can have that sort of temporary effect on you, but you have to get through that. It's very important. Because then you realize it is possible to speak truth here. No one's doing it. And so then you'd be saying, wow, this place, I must be really demoralized. Everyone must be really demoralized here. And then that, you know, frightens you. You say, oh, that's horrible. I thought we were all succeeding. And now I realize we're not. Well, we're trying, everyone here is trying to demoralize and disempower themselves. That is true. Very much so. But it's futile. See, they'll never succeed at it. So it is, when you hear the truth, you realize, hey, hardly anyone has this here. Hardly anyone has this. Wow. And you realize that people here are still very much into trying to demoralize themselves, which in itself can feel very demoralizing to realize this. That's why I couldn't sleep last night. I was very depressed, or not quite depressed, agitated. Anxious, stressed out. I didn't let it go into despondency or depression, no. But it's difficult to keep it from doing so. Difficult, for sure. So what do we do in the situation? I don't know. How to keep yourself from being, you know, demoralized It's like Jesus comes in the world and everyone says, wow, he's speaking the truth, but it's so demoralizing for us to realize just what a terrible situation we've tried to design for ourselves. And they say, we'd feel a lot better if we weren't here saying this, because then we could just go back into our fantasy that we're succeeding, you know? That, no, this is success, we're winning. So this is what we have to guard against. You can't kill the messenger, you know, you cannot. So we have to find a way to get past this feeling of like, oh, how demoralizing to find out that everyone here is so deluded and trying to demoralize them, disempower themselves. But if you look at it another way, it's great to start hearing the truth, you know? You realize, hey, God's not angry at us. God is not trying to annihilate us. God is saying, hey, you don't have to disempower yourself. I'm not trying to annihilate you if you fail at that. In fact, you can't help but fail at it. I'm not asking you to do the impossible. So this is the positive side of it. And that has to, you know, outweigh the temporary negative side of it, of thinking, wow, I don't really want to know that this whole situation is so terrible. The more we bring this to light, you know, the easier it gets, actually. The easier it gets. But to be able to ground the truth here in this world like this, at its very root, is what I wanted to do and been able to do this now. So that's great. Super difficult, because the world, first of all, believes that it must succeed in disempowering itself, and anything that dissuades it to keep trying is actually advocating its annihilation. In order to then keep trying, it says, well, let's better cut a compromise here, you know. This feels like we're being threatened, so let's make a compromise. And so you get trapped in all these so-called compromises, and the teaching becomes compromised then, and doesn't really help at all. Doesn't really help at all. So the discipline is this full stop in the wow. It has to be the discipline. If you're not doing that, you won't be able to get past this problem of saying, wow, if I'm aware of what we've been doing, that, you know, trying to demoralize ourselves, that awareness itself will demoralize me. So, see, that's the trap. So then you maintain delusion, thinking that this prevents you from being demoralized. But what it does is just keeps you involved in trying to disempower yourself. You see, it's really a catch-22, isn't it? Very much so. Which is why, throughout history, these techniques, this practice has been, we've been told we need to do this. Sit quiet, full stop, in the now of this wow. Not merely just churn words and concepts and all this kind of stuff. Doesn't matter what the words are or whatever. Doesn't matter. This is something way deeper than that. That's why it's a wow. And we're all free to get into that wow, for sure. I certainly have been too. It's a bit by bit by bit by bit by bit we get used to. Like, wow. So this is what's going on. Wow. I'm in a planet of people, of losers, those who are trying to lose, to destroy spirit. That's like... So without the encouragement of these teachers that I've been encouraged by, I don't think it's possible. Because they're just smiling, blissful, laughing, and see, they're not disempowered at all. And they do point out, this world is an anomaly. Said, this world is an insane asylum. Period. Jesus says, this world has nothing to do with what you are. Absolutely nothing to do with it. So this is very empowering. You know, it's like, wow. Okay. But most of them, like, they go to Sri Sri Anandamayi, Ma, and they say, oh, you're so beautiful, you're so wonderful. Won't you be our goddess for us? Won't you motivate us to disempower ourselves? You'd be great in that role. That's what Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru and the power brokers of India, that's what they went to her and put severe pressure on her to be a goddess figurehead of the whole country of Bharat, as they called it, and ultimately the figurehead for the whole world, because they felt that India would take over the spiritual dominion of the planet, and they wanted her to be this goddess figure, giving them advice, what they didn't understand. The advice that they were asking for is how to disempower themselves. It's exactly what they were looking for, and she turned them down flat, said, flat out, that's not what I'm here for, can't do that. Sorry. Yeah. So they've turned to other, you know, we all turn to other goddesses, but we think, well, if we could just get a goddess that was attractive as you, you know, then we would succeed. This is what we think. We see Anandamayi Ma, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, so, you know, beautiful and attractive. And we think if we just had a goddess like that who to guide us, we could finally succeed in, we could finally win. We could finally disempower ourselves, and then God would love us, and there'd be no more fear, and we'd all be saved, you see? that's how we take it. That's how most take it, most believe. That's how it's viewed. This is what we're hoping for. We're hoping for some uber goddess who's so attractive that we will listen to her guidance, even though we're feeling hideous and horrible and being so disempowered, we're thinking this is terrible, but we'll keep listening to her guidance, and she'll be able to finally attract us past this some bridge or some terrible gulf or void or something, where we'll be able to leap into disempowerment and succeed, because she's so attractive, she's there, and you're like, okay, I'll leap into disempowerment. That's what we're waiting for, hoping for. And working on. That's why there's so many women in this world who are desperately trying to conjure up some goddess archetype in their life, where they look, the way they act, where they talk, manners, everything. So many women are heavily into the goddess archetype and saying, don't worry, I will attract you to winning. Right. I will attract, come to the gambling casinos. I will attract you to winning. So this world's all about, I say, the goddess, corporate goddess culture of winning. Oh, don't worry, we'll attract you to winning. We'll show you how to disempower yourself. We'll attract you to disempowerment, spiritual disempowerment. That's exactly what's going on here. And you see all these wannabe goddess women, you know, and it's just so demoralizing, you know. Because their purpose is to attract you to quote-unquote winning, to quote-unquote salvation, which is really damnation. Damnation is the spirit's trying to disempower itself. Hell is spirit trying to disempower itself, which is this planet, for sure. This is one of the realms of hell. And of course, people don't want to hear that. They say, no, we're winning. There's a way to win, you know. Don't say that. The goddess is upset. You know, the goddess is upset. I'm not supposed to listen to this. And of course, men, political leaders, or society in general, is very attracted to these goddess archetypes because they think, oh, this is how we can win. We just need this greater attraction, greater seduction to disempowerment. That's our problem. And this is helping us. So we feel we're being helped by all this, you know. And anyone who says anything about it that points out what's really going on, oh, the Empress has no clothes, really. Oh, you're a pariah. You want us to lose. You're sabotaging our winning. You know, that kind of nonsense, you know. This is how it is here. This is how it is. As Jesus said, if you speak the truth here, everyone will hate you. And he's absolutely right. Almost everyone. Everyone will either hate you or be kind of like that. Not entirely hate you, but feel like, ah. It's dangerous, you know, dangerous person talking this. They're threatening me with the divine annihilation, that kind of thing. But what we point out, it was, of course, the root of the situation. Once you see that, then you don't hate it. You say, oh, great, this is wonderful. This is what I want to hear. The Bay Area of California is one of the most spiritually demoralizing places on the planet. It's like maybe the worst black hole on the planet, actually. It's just hideous. You know, I don't even crawl out of bed here. It's so bad. I don't even want to go out anywhere because just the people everywhere, their attitudes are so demoralizing, incredibly demoralizing. And of course, they feel this is the center of winning of the world. This is where winning is happening. And of course, again, our definition here in the planet of winning is to disempower spirit. And we think once we accomplish that, then God will love us, you know, the universe will love us. We'll feel universal love and say, oh, you succeeded, great. That's what you were created for, and you were successful in, your functionality has now been complete, you know. You're now functioning as you were created to function. You're supposed to disempower spirit, and now you've succeeded disempowering spirit, and so now God loves you, and you have been, you know, blissful eternal life forever and all. So they think they're winning. This is how severe the delusion is. And if they point that out to them, they'll look at you like you're completely crazy. Completely crazy. Again, they're not being repentant. They're not being honest. They're being dishonest. Because again, it wasn't God that gave us the mission to disempower God. It was our own desire to play with this idea of maybe our will is greater than God's. That is what's happening, and we're being dishonest about that. This is what's at play. Not God telling us that we're supposed to disempower God. That's not in play at all. Has never been in play, and never will be. So if you're being helped by this, give thanks to Jesus, the real Jesus, not the idol that this world of so-called winners who want someone to help disempower them. See, most of the world believes that Jesus was something that God sent to this world to help us succeed in disempowering ourselves. And that's why they say, thank you, God. You were going to annihilate us and kill us, but you loved the world so much that you sent your only son to die here, to be disempowered here, and that saved the world from your wrath. Otherwise, you were going to destroy the world because the world was not, we were not functioning the way you created us to function. That's not the real Jesus at all. That's how we interpret it, misinterpret it. The real Jesus is the one who points out there is no such dynamic from God, none whatsoever. There is no angry God. There is no God that's being threatened. There is no demand that we disempower ourselves from God. Never will be. There's no such dynamic from God whatsoever. God is this pure potentiality, non-preferential, but pure potentiality of absolute freedom and love and bliss, and that is all. This is the real Jesus that points this out. failing to disempower ourselves. We feel we're failing to function as God created us to, that God's going to annihilate us, and we're so desperate praying, God, for God, help us out. We can't figure out a way how to disempower ourselves. We're having such trouble. We're killing bodies, killing bodies. This still doesn't work. And then we think that God sent his only son to die, to be killed, to be disempowered. And saying, okay, you can't do it, but I'm going to do it for you here. So you don't get annihilated. So now you're saved. You just believe that I was able to disempower spirit, the Son of God, spirit, disempowered spirit. then you don't have to worry anymore. Excuse me. You don't have to worry anymore because I'm no longer angry at you. This is the fantasy, you know, that we think this is okay. We've been saved because God sent disempowerment here to this planet to do what we couldn't do, see, to disempower spirit for us. Now, I know that those listening who were like, oh, wait a minute. I was that way too before. So I know it's like, huh. You see, it's like we know there's something wrong somewhere. You know, something doesn't add up. We know that something doesn't add up. What I'm bringing to light is what it is that doesn't add up. But the problem is we're not sure, and we're still afraid of being annihilated here. So we say, well, maybe, you know, maybe we misinterpreted Jesus' mission here. We just assumed this is what it was because that's what we were praying for. And what Jesus really came to is saying, what you're praying for, you know, you don't need to keep praying for that. And we just assume that, okay, God was going to annihilate us, but we prayed for help, and God said, okay, I will do it for you. I will disempower spirit for you. Otherwise, you know, this is just a fantasy that we had. A fantasy of help. And Jesus came and said, no, that fantasy of help isn't helpful for you. That fantasy of help isn't helpful for you. But of course, coming into the world, we're going to project a fantasy upon Jesus, for sure. So Jesus said, no, what happened was just a projection of your fantasy upon me. But this is not God's will at all. And I will explain to you later on, as the Holy Spirit helps you out, then I will explain more clearly what God's will really is. That's what he said. So now he has returned and is explaining what God's will really is. And I'm an example of working with that explanation and getting it right, you see? So he has returned already and has been working with us and has clarified the whole situation. And that's the good news. That's the gospel. So, you know, you repent, you accept, oh, okay, I understand now that we just projected our own desire upon Jesus, our own dreadful, fearful fright that we thought salvation was, that we had to disempower ourselves. So we felt Jesus was the sacrificial disempowerment that saved us from the annihilation from God. You see, this is our fantasy we projected upon Jesus. And are continuing to project upon Jesus. But Jesus makes it adamantly clear now that that's all that it was. And he's not mad. God is not angry or mad, no. But truth remains truth. Truth remains true. Can't be changed. So he's done a beautiful job. Beautiful job. Explaining to us now, for those who are willing to work with this. Now it hasn't been easy at all. Partly because of the prevailing belief system of this planet still, but there were enough people in this world to kind of who said maybe wait a minute, let's reassess this whole situation, that I was able to sort of feel that there was at least some willingness on this planet to reassess the situation here. Reassess it. So So did Jesus know that this would happen? Of course, of course. You just know it. Jesus knew ahead of time we would project this fantasy of sacrificial disempowerment upon him, and believe that this then saved us from the wrath of God. In this delusionary projection of fear, fear-based projection. Of course, he knew that this would be projected upon him. But he also knew that we would reevaluate it, and the Holy Spirit would help us, and he'd come back later and clarify it for us. So this is all known in advance, of course. And he does point out now, and he says that a lot of very bitter idols have been made of him. Which is for sure, absolutely. But what do you expect? Of course that was going to happen. So I don't think he's upset. I mean, in the meeting I had with him, he wasn't upset or angry or anything like that, or depressed or demoralized or anything. Had a sense of humor about it all. But you know, I can imagine that there's at least, you know, that just a minute, a tinge, maybe just a tinge of like, it's gonna be great when we're all free from this delusion, you know, like that. Yeah, it's gonna be great when we've all set this down. It'll be a celebration, you know. But there's no anger there, you know. Maybe I wish that maybe it could just all go a little quicker, you know, a little quicker here. Yeah. When I met with Jesus, you know, it was several months ago, and while my body was asleep, and in spirit I met with Jesus, I was really assessing his attitude, is what I was really doing. We're chit-chatting, but I'm assessing his attitude. Is he angry? Is he disappointed? Is he frustrated? You know, is he... No, he's totally cool. Totally relaxed and humorous. Understandable. People just maybe just a little bit. Can we just? Can everybody just, you know? Hopefully, we can, you know, start making some progress. It'd be nice. Of course, we're free not to, but he understands our suffering for sure. He of course, Jesus knows we're trying to disempower ourselves. So of course we're in hell. I mean, in this hellish scenario of trying to disempower ourselves, we're trying to drive ourselves insane. So of course, if let's say you have some brothers and sisters who are and you're sane, and they're trying to drive themselves insane, I mean, you're going to feel compassion for that. You know, that's not going to make you happy. It's like, of course, he knows we can't. But still, we're like trying to, you know, drive ourselves insane, yeah. But he's not despondent at all. But I did feel like, there was sort of a calm patience there, of realizing that this, you know, a lot of progress still needs to be made. Yeah, so that sort of awareness. So, trouble is when we start really winning, there's a backlash that says thinks that's losing. So wait a minute. Wait a minute, we're supposed to succeed in driving ourselves insane, and now we're going towards sanity, and you can lose your nerve, you know, definitely. So I had to battle through all that. It's like, it was terrible. Even though I know God wasn't, from there was some massive feeling that was screaming at me. He says, no, God's going to annihilate you. What are you doing? What are you doing? We're here to help you. Go, turn away. And so it's just like, that makes you jittery. Even though you know deep down that God just doesn't have any, is not threatened. God can't be threatened. So how could God want to annihilate us? We can't threaten God at all. That was my understanding. So I just kept believing that. But still, there's just this roaring inferno telling you, you're going to destroy yourself. You're going to be annihilated. How dare you do this? This is, you know. So you feel super anxious. And there's a feeling like, if I just turn back, I won't have this anxiety. This is the trouble. This is why so many have come up short. The strain is severe. He who perseveres to the end shall be saved. You have to. This can be interpreted two different ways, right? That's the problem. Is that in this world we don't even realize that we have a false definition of winning. So we interpret whatever we hear, we interpret it to help us win. But if our definition of winning is to disempower ourselves, then we will interpret everything we hear to help drive ourselves insane, drives ourselves crazy. See? So it's this definition of winning that we need to shift. We need to flip the script, as I say. The definition of winning has to change. And that is, we need to set down our attempts to drive ourselves insane. That's winning. And the more we see it that way, the more we interpret truth correctly, right? And the more progress we make. But you can speak the truth in this world and people will just completely interpret it upside down and backwards and say, okay, this is what they said. Okay, I need to, okay, how can I use this? The base of the mind says, how can we use everything that's happening, everything, how can we use it to drive ourselves insane? How can we, whatever it is. So when Jesus came to the world, everybody in the world, almost everyone, even the apostles, said, how can we use Jesus to drive ourselves insane? They say, this looks, because we felt, wow, this thing's very helpful. So how can we use this helpfulness to drive ourselves insane? And therefore, please God, so God won't annihilate us. See? The whole notion of pleasing God is ridiculous. How could God not be pleased with God? All is God. How could reality doesn't need to be pleased by reality. Reality is inherently that way. Reality is totally inherent. There's nothing that needs to be done whatsoever for reality to be the way it is. Nothing whatsoever. So the notion of pleasing God implies that there's a possibility that we could displease God, which is completely impossible. We're perfectly free. This is the pleasure of God. This is. And we can never not be perfectly free. So it's the issue of pleasing God is a total non-issue. Total, complete non-issue. Our freedom is worshiping the worship of God. Reality is the worshiping of reality, intrinsically, inherently, without anything needing to be done whatsoever. We're not some creatures created to please God like that, to please God. Reality inherently pleases reality. It's impossible not to. But here we are trying to figure out what we need to do to please God. Let's do these prayers and rituals and do this and this and this. We gotta please God because deep down we're afraid, like if we don't please God, something terrible is going to happen. And then we think that somehow this disempowering scenario that we have dreamed up is God is the one who authored this. And then so all this terrible stuff that happens here, we think that we've displeased God. You know, something we've done is displeasing to God. We need to learn how to please God better. This is the madness of this place. This place is entirely our own handiwork, designed to drive ourselves insane. This and demoralize us to the point where we feel we've been disempowered. So sure, we have some good times here. That's just a setup for the bad times to come. Oh, we're having our nice little fertile land here with the rice and crops, and we have this happy singing and everything. Oh, whoops. Where's the rain? The rain's supposed to come. Oh, it didn't come this year. Whoops. Wow. Okay, we sing and dance a little more, and next year, no rain. I say, oh, let me go consult the local shamans, you know. They say, oh yes, God is angry at you, and you need to start, you know. So now we start singing and dancing to God. Say, hey God, you know, we're sorry. We're sorry we displeased you. We're sorry we did something wrong. We repent, but we don't, you know, we're trying to do what you created us for here. We're trying to do it, and we're just not quite sure how to do it. Can you just advise us, please? And then go to the local shamans, hey, shaman, you know, or shamaness. The shaman, actually, go to the shaman says, well, what you really need to do is go to the shrine of the goddess, and she will inform you what to do. Oh, okay. And so then the goddess says, you need to, you know, bring gifts to me, and, you know, empower me more. You need to believe in me more. Okay, goddess, okay. And then, you know, it still doesn't rain, and everybody's dying of famine, and everybody still says, oh, God, please, please, please. And eventually the oscillation of the ocean changes, and the rains turn. I say, oh, God, listen to our prayers. You see, God, listen to our prayers. Yeah, 10 million starved to death, and many more died of illness and everything. But God, now a new cycle is beginning. You know, a new cycle is beginning. And then another positive cycle gets ready for another negative cycle, you know. This is all total madness, okay? We're trying to drive ourselves insane by all this. This world and the functioning of it is totally our own handiwork, 100%. Designed to disempower us, okay? Disempower, to drive ourselves, drive us insane. So, of course, that's how it's working. God has nothing to do with it. God has nothing to do with worlds or universes or anything like that. What God has to do with is everything. See, God has to do with pure potentiality of everything, always. See, nothing specific or determinate in particular at all. God is the base, the ground of allness, of allness. So you can say, well, yes, God has something to do with this universe, but you can't parse it out like that. No, God has to do with allness always. All potentiality. So there's nothing that God doesn't have to do with, and nothing particular God has to do with. It's all indeterminate. It's all pure potentiality. So we can make of that whatever we want to. You see? So we have made of that this world. We have made of that this world. And God doesn't tell us to get rid of the world. It's indifferent in terms of whatever we want to make of pure potentiality, we're free to make of it. Whatever we want to make of pure potentiality, we're always free to make of it. Anything we want to make of it whatsoever, that is God. All God does is remind us that we're free to set this down. See, we think that we need to use this until we disempower our spirit. And of course we can't disempower spirit, so we feel like we're stuck with this forever. And God just is just reminding us, Jesus is reminding us, hey, you know, you're free to keep this as long as you want. You're also totally free to set it down with no judgment whatsoever from God, none. So God's not telling us we must set it down necessarily like that, but saying you're free to set it down if you want to. This instant, this very instant, you're completely free to set it all down as if it never was. And you're free to play with pure potentiality in this way again if you want to. This is what God tells us. And of course we want to set it down because not, but it's an experiencing we don't really like at all. Because it's an experiencing which is trying to tell us that we're not free and that we are bound. And this is not our nature. This is not what we, this is not our functionality. So we're not really functioning the way God created us per se. Our functionality has not been damaged in any way, but trying, believing and trying to hold on to something forever as if we have to, that's not really our function. You know, we're not really functioning the way that we are created to function. But we still are. Because, again, this is arising this instant. So our function, but we're trying to not function the way we are created. Let's put it this way. We're trying to not function the way we are created to function. Even though we're failing at that, we're still, it's as if we are not, because we're trying to, you see. And we're not happy with that. We're not happy with it. It doesn't feel right to us at all. But there are no demands from God that we set it down. None whatsoever. None whatsoever. If that was the case, then God would be disempowered. There's no demand we set it down. None. We keep thinking that we have to, once we succeed, then God will tell us, okay, you don't need that anymore. Now you can set it down because you finally succeeded in disempowering yourself. So now I will give you a heavenly realm for having succeeded so well. It doesn't work like that. Doesn't work. You don't get to heaven like that. You get to heaven by accepting God as God is, where there is no demand to set this down. There's also no demand that we keep it. Neutral, indifferent, pure potentiality. No preferences from God. No preferences. It's only when we realize the no preferenceness of God that then we feel free to set it down. And then we can play with, you know, a paradise realm and death-free realm. We can play with that potentiality, and any and all potentialities, actually. But we may choose to play with the potentiality of like a supernature once we set this down, because we want some familiarity. We're so used to this, we're not ready to just be totally abstract, you know. We still have a sense of familiarity, so why not play with the pure potentiality in the form of, in the play of supernature. Death-free realm, supernature, beautiful supernature. No drought. No drought. No disempowerment there. No play of disempowerment at all. See, supernature is no play of disempowerment at all. So it seems like that there's no play of nature hardly, you know? No play of nature, really. Because this here, what we call nature, is just the play of disempowerment. That's all it is. It's our play. We're playing with pure potentiality, which is God. Playing this play of attempting to disempower ourselves, disempower spirit. So it's the play of disempowerment is what we call, quote-unquote, nature. That's what we call nature. And you think, oh, this is the work of God. This is God created nature for us, and we're a creature, and we're doing nonsense. This is just our own play with pure potentiality. And so supernature, it seems like, well, where's all the play of disempowerment? It's not there, you know. But if you take it the right way, you say, wow, how beautiful, how wonderful. Yeah, you could do that too. That's one of the options. Of course, actually, all options are open to us. But because of the continuity fear, it's likely that there's some options that seem more preferable to us. We'll think, you know what, I think I want to play with this option. It seems a little more like what I'm used to. Because we've been used to this play of disempowerment we call, or attempt at disempowerment we call nature, for so long. We might want something that has some, you know, tinges of familiarity to this. It's perfectly okay. Again, God doesn't have any preferences. We're created perfectly free, no preferences. God is simply all pure potentiality, is always present, always, always perfectly present. Can never change in any way that fact. So we're always free. All options are always available to us, every instant. All options are available to all. every instant. All options available to all every instant. All options available to all every instant. But you, now you can see why I'm just taping this here and making it available to the world and not talking to an audience of people or so such and such. Because you can imagine saying this kind of stuff to an audience, people, the hackles are going to raise, you know, just like, whoa, slow down. Wait a minute. Wait, we're playing with fire here, you know, like, this is a fear of, like, you know, that, thinking that we're children of nature and God created all this kind of stuff, you know, it gives rise to always a massive fear, thinking, you know, they say, okay, you know, so, yeah, it's, I don't know how this could be, how this could be said to people, you know, in the world, just directly, yeah, I don't know. Maybe that's why Jesus transmits this information through just one or two people. And then that goes out and you can read it in a book and stuff. But if Jesus came here and told you this directly, you know, you'd just like probably come on, freak out. You'd be so frightened now. If Jesus came and told me this now, I wouldn't freak out. I'd say, hey, you don't expect me to go tell the world in general this, do you? Get crucified to try to push this upon the world in general. All these criminal goddess syndicates, you know, would be, you know, they'd say, how dare you blaspheme our goddess, the one who's leading us to salvation through the wonders of nature, the wonders of disempowerment, the miraculous, wondrous play of nature, the mysterious play of nature, how it manages to disempower us, how we don't know how it does it, but somehow mysteriously, we always say God works in such mysterious ways, and we say nature is how, you know, yes, we all think nature has some secret, you know. No, it doesn't. We keep believing nature has some secret. There's no secret to nature. Well, the secret is it doesn't work. That's the secret. But we think that it does work, we just can't figure out how, and eventually it'll be revealed to us. The goddess will lead us to the secret and reveal our disempowerment, and that'll save us from the wrath of God. And then we'll be able to live happily ever after with the goddess in our little nature kingdom, you know. Yeah. Now, this is like if you weren't here in this world and you're looking at this world, you could talk like this and laugh and you know, it'd be funny. It's you have a humor about it. But when you're here in this world, it's not so easy to talk this way, you know, and laugh about it. You're like, what are you laughing at? Why are you criticizing nature? You know, like, you know, oh boy, get very prickly about it. They might be very nice, you know, but still, don't say this stuff. Don't say this stuff. You can't say this stuff. The goddess will get angry. She'll think that I'm not paying attention to her, and I feel God's going to be angry at me, annihilate me. I'm going to fail. I need to pay attention to nature all the time, otherwise I might fail. I still haven't discovered the secret. I'm getting close, though. I know I'm getting close, but I just quite haven't discovered it. The secret is, there is no secret. It's futile. It doesn't work. That's the secret. That's the little dirty little secret nobody wants to hear. It doesn't work. We can't disempower ourselves. And guess what? God did not tell us we had to. So, no threat to God, no threat to us. Everything's perfectly fine. We can set nature down this instant as if it never existed, and it would not cause even the tiniest reaction from God whatsoever, from all that is, zero. Jesus said, nothing real is threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Therein lies the peace of God. Therein lies the peace of God. you know, I haven't been told because I might feel like, wow, that's too good. You know, I don't know if I can, you know, but by bringing this all to light and getting comfortable with it, I know it somehow it's opening up my options, which I could certainly pass on to everyone else and just say, hey, you have options. Ultimately, we have all options. In fact, right now, we have all options. But this is the fear, right? The fear of realizing that all options are open to us this instant, open to all. All options open to all, always. Realizing that, potentially we think it'll freak us out. Because we're used to thinking this nature is just the only option there is, and this forever, this is it. So can the contrast, I call it a continuity problem, that's our real problem. So it's pragmatic to say, well, yes, all options are open, but let us be pragmatic here because of this weird situation we're in. And since we're perfectly free to choose any option we want, let's make a pragmatic choice right now. And let's choose an option which helps with this continuity issue that we're struggling with here, okay? God is not trying to rush us back into just total, free, glorious experiencing. And, you know, we can't ever not leave that. It's impossible. So there's no rush or pressure or anything. So we can afford to be pragmatic. Absolutely. That's not against reality in the slightest bit. Might say we're being a little timid. Well, that's fine. That doesn't change reality either. But we're just being smart is what we're being actually. Very wise. I say, hey, I got this continuity issue, so let me choose something that's kind of similar. Okay, a similar play with pure potentiality, except we're not playing with a scenario designed to try and demoralize, drive ourselves insane, and disempower us, okay? We're not playing with that anymore, but we're playing with something that has some similar, some tint of similarity, you know, supernature, for instance. Oh, the forms are there. Oh, beautiful garden, beautiful park, everything's so wonderful. Oh, there's no death there. There's no disease. There's no drought. There's no cycles of death, you know, and birth and death. Oh, everything's just like immaculate. Everything's beautiful. So, oh yeah, that's a nice option. The supernature is the immaculately virginal world, the unborn immaculately virginal world. This is the real symbology of the Virgin Mary, for instance, the immaculate virginal world, which is simply an option that we can exercise, an option of playing with pure potentiality, an option which helps solve the continuity problem. It's a symbol. When Jesus says, well, you know, when people say, this, well, the whole symbol of that, this is what is being pointed to actually. It's not being pointed to a goddess. But because we're so used to goddesses attracting us to destruct, trying to destroy ourselves, that most of us feel like, yeah, we kind of need a mother figure, this goddess mother figure, to attract us to supernature. Okay. So this is how I see the use of the Virgin Mary. And this is something common throughout about history throughout this planet. Is this? We got to be very careful because that can easily be twisted into listening to a goddess attracting us to our quote-unquote damnation or destruction, siren. But again, what we're being attracted to is not a goddess, but supernature, our play with pure potentiality in a way which has similarities to nature without the trying to drive us insaneness about it. Doesn't have the trying to drive us insaneness about it. Doesn't have the trying to disempower usness about it. So it's immaculately virginal, unborn, you see. No reproduction there. No cycles of nature there. See, this is what it's pointing to. Jesus, this whole thing is very symbolic. Born of a virgin is very symbolic. It's pointing us out the option of supernature. No cycles there. No cycles. The weather is steady. The atmosphere is steady. It always seems optimal. It always seems perfect. Everything always seems perfect there in supernature. Everything there affirms spirit. It's spirit affirming instead of demoralizing. Instead of spirit demoralizing, it's spirit affirming. Everything in supernature, it's just massive affirmation of spirit. It's just beautiful affirmation of spirit. And you just feel like, wow, I'm being so affirmed. I'm being so affirmed. You may wonder, how come Jesus hasn't said all this stuff? Well, keep in mind, 2,000 years ago, he understood that everyone would project their fear upon him and see him as if he were fulfilling their need, what they felt was their need, to disempower spirit, fulfilling that role, you know, and then therefore saving him from the wrath of God. He understood that would be projected upon him. And now he understands, coming back, clarifying it, he understands that we're still jittery about this, okay, very jittery. So he's not going to just come out and say, you know, hey, welcome to supernature, you know. We had to get through all this, you know, this intermediate step, phase 2, 3, and 4, before we can get this invitation to supernature, which I received from him. After I talked with him and assessed his attitude, at the end of that, after I said, okay, he's all's good, I said, wow. This is acceptable. That's when he said, hey, would you like to visit my place, my dwelling place? Would you like to visit my dad? I said, yeah, of course I would. Great. Because I assessed his attitude, you know. And there's no wrath, no fear, no disappointment. You know, everything's fine. It's all good. It's all steady. So I said, sure, I would. So that's when the invitation came, you see, after I'd worked through all this stuff. So that's why it's not in A Course in Miracles, it's not in Journey Beyond Words, it's not directly, it didn't directly bring this out, because it would have overwhelmed us, it would have been too difficult. Because we're still struggling through this whole fear thing of God, fear of God thing, you know, that's a heck of a difficult climb out of that. Very difficult climb, so doesn't want to overwhelm us. So I know everyone's still waiting for the return of Jesus. Jesus, the return's already happened. It's already happened in the 60s, 1960s, return of Jesus. And what was Jesus' first coming here? Deliver the good news to us. It got rejected then, of course, out of fear. What's the return of Jesus? To deliver the good news, of course. But this time, there's a little more acceptance of it. A little more acceptance of it. See? So, yeah, Jesus has already returned. So we don't need to keep waiting for that. We need to start listening to what the good news, the gospel. Get it right this time, you know. Don't interpret in a fearful way as we did previously. We've had 2,000 years of fearful interpretation with a little bit of diminishment, right? There has been some diminishment. Absolutely there has. Bit by bit, little bit, little bit, little bit, little bit, little bit. There has been some diminishment of the fear of God. but much of that based on thinking that we are winning and we are succeeding in driving ourselves insane. So we think, okay, we don't need to be so afraid of God because we've almost succeeded in driving ourselves insane. So there's that feeling. That's partly in the mix too. But there's also some reevaluation, like, hey, wait a minute, you know, God is love. God is not, well, you know, if God is love, why is it, God can't be threatened, you know? God's love, how come? So there's been some reassessment take place over the last couple thousand years. So some of us are able to do this. That's why I found A Course in Miracles 1978. I was able to do it. Jesus said, hey, you're able to do it, go for it. That's why I came into the world. Jesus told me, you can do it. Go into the world, get it done. You can do it. That's what I was told, I can do it. So I was like, so I got into it early 1978 and have been going full blast ever, you know, full blast on it. But I actually got started from the very get-go. I came into this world totally focused on saying, I'm gonna do this. And so I was studying spiritual teachings from the get-go, totally attuned to it and focused on it, whole life, entire life, from the get-go. So it absolutely is possible to get through all this nonsense. And everyone, we all have to do that for sure. Eventually, we all have to give up this attempt to disempower ourselves, because we can't disempower ourselves. We are God. All is God. And all is pure potential, always, to play with all options. All has all options available, always. That's not disempowerment. It's impossible to be disempowered. And it doesn't matter if the goddess is mad at you, because that's just a projection of our own projection, of our own fear. There is no goddess, actually. There isn't anything like that. You think, oh my gosh, she'll be so angry with me. No, we're just angry at ourselves. We're, you know, there isn't any. All is pure. All options are available to all, always. This is reality, and this is now. No such thing as any goddess interfering with any of that, okay? Reality cannot be interfered with. But as we get fearful of the truth, we project that fear and anger onto the goddess, and then you get the goddess be angry with us and say, how come you're not listening to me? Because, you know, we're trying to motivate ourselves to go back and try to, you know, drive ourselves insane again, because we get frightened of that. So we think, oh, the goddess is so angry with me, she's disappointed, she's not going to give me, you know, the paradise she's promised me. And this is just motivational tactics, how we're trying to motivate ourselves. There isn't any actual goddess at all. Nothing. There's only God. There's only pure potentiality. All options available to all, always. There's only that. There's only that. No motivational devices needed. None whatsoever. Reality doesn't have any motivational devices whatsoever. None needed. So don't worry about displeasing the goddess. That's all nonsense. Keep focusing on truth and full stop in the wow. Don't even go into any dynamic of a reaction with some guide or guidance you're supposedly getting or something. How are they going to take this? No, that's all a fantasy. Just full stop in the now of this wow. Like, wow. I'm finally hearing the gospel. I'm finally hearing the good news. Just wow, that's it. All options are always available to all. And we're aware of pragmatism. So we'll choose something. We'll play with pure potentiality in a way which seems similar in some way to what we're used to, but without the disempowerment motif there. It'll be affirming spirit. Okay, this is gospel. This is good news. Just say, wow, I'm hearing the good news. This is great. I'm hearing the good news. This is very affirming. Very affirming. And again, I don't need to affirm disempowerment. I don't need to do that. So this is affirming. This is affirming reality. See, no need to disempower myself to please God. No need for that. So I don't need to affirm the seductress who's luring me. I don't need to reaffirm the lure that is luring me to try and drive myself insane. I don't need to affirm that anymore. I'm affirming the gospel. New Testament. Jesus brought a New Testament. I'm affirming the good news that none of that is necessary. That's all a silly whim I had of trying to have a greater will than God. And I don't need to do that anymore. So, this is good. This is affirming. This is the gospel. Full stop in the affirmation of this wow. Full stop in the now of this affirming wow. Full stop in the now of this affirming wow. But don't go and discuss this with all the little god and goddess wannabes in the world who, you know, say, what do you think about this? You know, you need to help me too. And you get in a conflict. Which way do I go? Which way do I go? Which way do I go? You get pulled this way and pulled this way, and it becomes very conflictual, very conflictual. If you discuss it with the lures, the allure, you know, they'll say, well, I can do that too. Don't worry. I'll track you to that too. Don't worry. Don't do that. Just stay full stop in the now of this affirming wow. And see. Find out how it feels. Get used to the feeling of having your spirit affirmed, having reality affirmed, having reality affirmed. This is what it's all about. This is how you have your morale boosted. Have spirit affirmed. Have your freedom, truth affirmed for you. How does it feel? How does the affirmation of spirit feel? How does the affirmation of truth feel? How does it feel? Now, so jittery, yeah, but that's fine. I just stick with the jitteriness. But underneath that, we realize, hey, I like this. I really like this. I got a continuity problem, some jittery, familiarity problem, but I like this. This is great. I love the affirmation of truth. I love the affirmation of truth. So just stay in the full stop in the now. Of this affirmation of truth, the wow of the affirmation of truth, full stop in the now of this, of the wow of this affirmation of truth, just full stop and just enjoy it, just abide in it. Even though it's temporary, it feels like a strain. Later on, you'll start to feel like, wow, this is great. The positivity of it will arise more and more and more. For example, when I got the invitation to visit Jesus' dwelling place, I was like, yes! Wow, this is great! This is what I really want. This is really like, this is tremendous. I feel, wow, this is really going to be a great affirmation of my spirit, of spirit, of truth, of reality. This is great. See? So, it does pay off. Rain coming in California, one after another. Yep, another storm coming in a few days. A little rain tonight actually. And tomorrow morning, then Thursday, heavy rain. Friday, lots of showers, lots of precipitation. And then a few more days later, a little break, and then some more are supposed to come in. So we're getting regular pulses coming in like this, which does indicate that the drought may be, that this drought dynamic may be coming to an end, or at least, you know, it's given way to a more normal cycle. Sure looks that way. Sure feels that way. Don't know how, you know, January, February, March, April, May will go, but December is certainly showing that that high pressure rate is no longer deflecting everything. It's not there anymore. So that's great. That's great. Oh, sort of winding down from this. But how do you wind down from a video like this? I don't know. Probably not possible. All right. Very great. And if you feel like a spiritually buzz, okay, yeah, that's just get used to it. Just say, yeah, just abide in the wow of this spirit affirming wow, truth affirming, spirit affirming, reality affirming, gospel of good news. Wow, it's really good news, isn't it? Really good news. This is really, really powerful good news. And if you're just like shaking, that's fine. That's probably a normal reaction, you know, trembling. Yeah. It's like, wow. I don't have to be fearful forever. I don't have to drive myself insane. I don't have to disempower myself. At all. That's great news. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.